Good morning. Good morning. Happy Halloween. All right. Good to have you all here. Welcome to all the people viewing on the web. It's nice to have all of you with us all across the world. My name is Rachel Carpenter, and I am the programming director here at Cornerstone. Just going to fill you in on a couple of things before we really get rolling here this morning. If you are new with us this morning, or if maybe you haven't filled one out before, there's a card in the seat pocket in front of you. It's called the flap. We'd love to have you take just a minute to fill that out. Give us your contact information. Let us know if there's any way we can help you, if there's any information you need from us. It's a good way to keep in contact with us, make sure that we can let you know of the great things that are going on here at Cornerstone. So please, especially if you're new, take just a second, fill that out. There'll be a time for you to turn it in at the end of the service during our offering. Or if you are new, if you're a first-time visitor with us, please fill that out and return it to the Welcome Center out in the lobby when the service is over with. They have a special gift for you, so make sure that you do that. Right now, we're in the middle of a series that we call Seasons. We've covered spring already, which is kind of that time in life when you're making some big decisions and you're setting the stage for what's to come and the things that you're going to manage throughout the rest of your life. Last week we talked about the summer season. That's the summer where you're building your life, you're building your family, and you're getting your stuff together. And this week, Pastor Brent is going to be sharing with us about the autumn season, which is fairly apropos, I would say, for where we're at. And I'm sure it's going to be really powerful and very, very challenging and a great learning experience for all of us, because it's going to talk to us about how we then invest our life. Once we've built things and once we've gotten our stuff together, how do we invest? How do we make a difference? So it's going to be a really, really, really great morning. Now, the thing that has occurred to me is that what we have here is kind of like a lunar eclipse. Okay, it really doesn't come around all that often. Yesterday I was looking at my cell phone and I saw the date and I went, oh my goodness, tomorrow's Halloween. And then I went, oh my goodness, tomorrow's Sunday. And that's kind of weird, like Halloween on a Sunday? It's a little bit like good versus evil, like duking it out for the rights to the day, right? I mean, we kind of think of it that way, and we wonder, like, who owns this day? But then you realize, oh wait, who owns it? God, it's Sunday. Of course God owns the day, right? But then there is the whole football thing and the whole sleeping in late so you actually kind of miss some of church thing, right? And then you throw Halloween in the mix, and it all just got a little bit, you know, weird for me. And can you imagine being a little kid this morning? You wake up, you're all stoked, you're super excited for the big event, and, oh yeah, I gotta go to church first. That's right. I bet you we got a whole bunch of confused little kids back there right now. It's hard for them to focus. All they can think about is sugar, sugar, sugar. They're waiting for trick-or-treating coming. And actually, that makes me think of when I was a kid, because when you're a kid and it's Halloween, it's all about the candy, right? Exactly. Although it is a little bit about the costume. Costume's kind of important. I know a costume can kind of make it or break it, right? But when I was a kid, we didn't really spend a lot of money on costumes. We sort of did the whole, like, let's go to the Goodwill or see what we have around the house kind of thing. So I always ended up being like a princess or a clown by default. Like, princess, I'd put on like a Sunday dress and my mom's homecoming tiara. Or like a clown, it'd be dad's big flannel shirt and like lipstick circles on my face and on my nose, you know? So, wait, where was I talking? Oh, right. Halloween Sunday. That's what we're talking about. And it doesn't really like roll off the tongue, you know? It's like we've got Monday Night Football. I mean, that sounds right, you know? Okay, and Taco Tuesday. That even sounds kind of normal. And TGI Fridays, that really rolls off the tongue. I love their fried mac and cheese. But Halloween Sunday, it just doesn't, I don't know, it doesn't fit. And, you know, the thing was, Halloween, when I was growing up, it was like you had permission to get a little bit spooked. It's like you kind of wanted to. You wanted to have that little adrenaline rush and feel scared and, you know, all of that. And that sort of added to the whole fun of going out and getting the candy is, you know, somebody might jump out at you or do something crazy. And it's kind of strange for me to think about that, because I think, how can you be a little bit spooked on God's day? And I don't know. So now I'm conflicted about the whole Halloween thing and the church and God's day thing. And then it hit me. That's kind of interesting, because I've always separated the two. There's been like God's day and God things, and then there's been Halloween. God and Halloween. And then that made me think, that's kind of how I live my life sometimes. I separate out God things, God experiences, God people, and then like Halloween stuff, the things I like to do over here that I keep separate, that, you know, maybe have as much ceremony and as much bad to them as going out and getting some candy. And that made me realize that maybe sometimes I'm lukewarm at best. And what does the Bible say about lukewarm? It says that it's best to be either hot or cold. But being lukewarm is like a dog returning to its own vomit. Which the image kind of makes me throw up in my mouth a little bit right now, actually. And it's what I've realized is that I'm not so much conflicted about Halloween and then Sunday as I am convicted. I'm convicted that I can live my life in categories and not all together. I'm convicted that I live separate with God stuff and then worldly stuff. And that's just not how we're supposed to do it. And sometimes that's hard to admit. But if we recognize it in our life, we can start to integrate and make God a part of all of it, and vice versa. So what about you? What about you? For me, this Sunday, it's Halloween. Bring it on, man. Bring it on. Because let's be reminded that God owns the day. He owns every day. He owns every day before it, every day after it. God owns the day. And so the world can bring all the ghosts and the goblins and the ghouls and all that, all the spirits, because guess what? I have the one true spirit, the Holy Spirit, and that's what I'm going to take with me this Halloween, and I'm going to celebrate it. Does God own every day for you, or are you going to live your life with separate events and people? Today is All Saints' Day. It's All Hallows' Eve. Halloween. It's not the devil's day. It's the Lord's day. So we're going to celebrate this great day with laughter and with fun, and we're going to learn, and we're going to celebrate the one who overcame the greatest enemy of all, which is death. He made eternal life ours because he is alive forever. He's the reason we sing, the reason we dance, the reason we laugh, the reason we celebrate. He is the source of all true fun and joy. So Halloween Sunday, kind of catchy.
Halloween is an evil and horrible holiday, created for evil and horrible people to show off how evil and horrible they are. If you want your kids to worship demons and mingle with the local heathen children on Satan's Christmas, then go ahead and let them trick-or-treat. Sure, you're meeting neighbors and new people in your community in a friendly context, and your kids get to dress up and create memories that will last a lifetime, but it's evil. Try to find a harvest festival at a local church instead. Sure, the candy's not as good, and the costumes are boring, but at least you're surrounded by the Holy Spirit, and not those horrible and evil people in your community. These have been Deep Thoughts from a Shallow Christian.
I was working in the lab late one night, when my eyes beheld an eerie sight, for my monster from its slab began to the monster man. It was a graveyard smash. It caught on in a flash. He did the monster man. From my laboratory in the castle east to the master bedroom where the vampires feast, the ghouls all came from their humble abodes to get a jolt from my electrodes. Then you can monster mash, and do my graveyard smash. You'll catch on in a flash. Then you can monster mash.
All right, everybody, stand up and greet somebody near you. Wish them a happy Halloween.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name. your glorious name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Blessed Redeemer, be so amazing. Love so
looking for. And then there are times when we just need to cry out, Jesus, be our center. If there's something in me that I just can't move out of the way, then help me move it. Be our center. Let that be our prayer this morning as we sing. And as we worship Him, this altar is open.
Jesus, be my faith. Jesus, be my center.
Sing it again.
Jesus, be my center
of my life. Sing it again.
Jesus, be my center.
Be my hope and song.
Be my hope, be my song.
Be my hope and song.
Be my hope, be my song.
Be the fire.
Be the fire.
Was talking about autumn, and I just wondered where fall fits in. We call it the fall. And then I watched and observed these who came forward here this morning and fell on their knees before an almighty God, trusting in him. And I'm going to ask Pastor Brenda and Son He to come forward down here at the altar so we can pray for them. And for those that don't know what's going on here, Brenda, our pastor, and Son He, our interpreter, are going to go to Korea, and they leave today. So I want to pray for them. Father, we know that you're the God of the universe. Father, we know you're almighty. You're ever-present. Lord, we know that you're in control of all things. Lord, it was your plan that the people in Korea wanted to hear from Brenda. We know, Lord, that you're leading her there. And to help her, I can't think of a better helper than Son He. Oh, Lord, we pray for both of these ladies. Our heart goes with them. We're family. And it's like cutting our hearts out of us and separating us from them. But Father, we know that in Jesus' name that you're going to be with them. We do pray for Brenda's health, Lord, that she be strong. Lord, that you give her an extra portion of Holy Spirit. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, and Lord, that you would use her in a mighty way. Father, a part of us are going to Korea, but we know that through the power of your Holy Spirit that we're all going with them, for they're our representative. They represent what everything that this Cornerstone Church is about, and it's all about your love, Lord. And so we send them to those in Korea with love. Lord, we know that you're all about love. We know that every good thing comes from you. And so, Father, I pray that you be with these traveling mercies. No complications with luggage or any of that kind of discomfort. Lord, that you would just be with them and carry them there and carry them home and bring them home safe and sound. Lord, as I said, it's like having our heart cut out of us. Some of us are going to be lost without them. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us who are left behind to be faithful and to carry on the message of Cornerstone and so that they have that support. And Lord, that all of us might fall on our knees. Fall season, good time to fall on your knees. But this time, this fall, we need to fall on our knees for Brenda and Sonny. And Lord, we thank you for the love that you give us. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. And for anyone here, Lord, that may not know you, then this may be the time when they see you in action. And they might come to this altar and surrender their heart to you. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
If I have to. Come in, it's open.
Good morning.
No.
What?
No.
What are you talking about?
We both know that you're here to drag me off to some do-gooder something or other, and the answer is no. Not again, not this week.
Chair, we've been friends since kindergarten. If I can't trust you and rely on you, who can I?
I am all for saving the world, but does it have to be every Saturday? Dude, I'm sorry, I just can't.
You can't?
Nope, forbidden by law.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. Section 13, Article 4 of the official rules of this apartment and this couch specifically state there will be no movement on Saturday morning unless specifically willed by the maker of such laws. Which, by the way, is me, and I feel no such need to move. Therefore, my answer to you is no, no, and no. What are you doing? Going to the dump?
No, I'm going to the recycling center.
Oh, well, la-dee-da.
Dear, I'm concerned about you.
No, I bet you are.
It's really not that bad.
I bet it's not.
Just listen to me.
Nope.
Come on, give me 30 seconds.
Not half that.
30 seconds.
Okay, fine, go.
Wait, I didn't know you were going to start
25.
Yet. I don't handle stress well. Now, slow down.
Five.
Oh, you skipped. That's not right.
All right, you ready to 10?
Oh, no, you did that one on purpose.
Five. Oh. Four. Three.
Okay.
Two.
I need your
one.
Help.
Oh, please. You do not.
Yeah, Jerry, I do.
Every week, same thing. You come in here with some cockamamie thing to drag me off to, and I end up regretting it for the rest of my week and possibly the rest of my life.
That's not true.
Yes, it is. What was it? Last week. Same thing, Jerry, I need your help.
I've done that a couple times. Maybe.
Before I knew it, there I was standing knee-deep in 10W30 recycled oil, soaked to the bone.
Now, somebody has to care for the environment.
And the week before that, what was it? Oh, yeah, I remember stuffing junk mail for the senior citizens.
That was important there.
Oh, please, how is... A Caribbean cruise for seniors important.
There were other things on the cruise that we were going to work on. You know that.
You are one of the most annoying friends I have ever had.
Well, thanks.
That is not a compliment. Every week, it's the same thing. You come in here, you ruin my weekend, and you ruin my life.
I'm not going to ruin it again this time, I promise.
Now, you can't be trusted.
won the game.
What?
The game.
Which game?
You know,
Wait a minute. Why do you even care?
Was it a good game?
It was a great game.
Awesome!
All right. What?
What?
What are you trying to talk me into this weekend?
I told you about my nephew.
You have a nephew?
Oh, he's a great kid.
Is anything like you?
A little bit.
I got no desire to know him.
He likes sports.
So he's not much like you?
No, not that much.
So
he's having trouble in school.
Sounds like a pretty normal kid to me.
He's 9 years old, and I think his teacher said he's having trouble with reading. And she said if she could have somebody to come alongside and mentor him and help him, that, you know, that he could understand.
Why are you whispering?
His name is Josh, and let's just say he and his Uncle Pike don't relate very well.
He doesn't like you, does he?
No, he likes me a lot, but he just doesn't understand me.
Yeah, he sounds like a pretty smart kid, too.
2 days a week.
2 days a week?
Tuesdays and Thursdays after school. Let's say from 3:30 to 4:15.
I have to work for a living.
Okay. 6:15 to 7 o'clock after work.
Pike!
Okay.
No, I do not wish to meet him.
Why not?
Pike, I am so slammed that I only get 2 days a week to do anything, and I cannot take 2.5 hours out of my time schedule to take some kid that I don't even know. I mean, look at me. I've got no friends. I've got no social life. I got no girlfriend. And I call you my friend? When's the last time I was even out to see a movie?
Okay.
All right.
I'll go tell him.
You what?
I'll go tell him.
He's here?
Hey, Josh.
Oh, Pike, you didn't.
Hey, buddy. This is my friend, Jerry.
Hi. How you
remember
doing?
Remember what we were talking about earlier?
Yeah.
Here, I want you to do this. Have a seat. Jerry's going to talk to you
what
about
What do you mean
that.
I'm going to talk
I'm
to him?
What do you mean? Get
back. Pike, what are you
bit.
Doing?
Okay,
you get back here and talk to this child. Pike! Oh. So, this tutoring thing, does it pay well?
Tutoring?
Yeah, well, you know.
Brown's one.
Yeah, it was a miracle. Well, you want to read about it?
Sure.
Check this out. I'll start you, okay? In an interview today, the Browns manager said,
if we manage the game like we did today and not turn over the ball, we always have a chance to win a ball game, says McCoy, who completed 9 of 16 passes for 74 yards. The offense line played tremendous because with the crowd noise, it's hard on them to hear the snap count. They could barely hear me in the huddle.
I thought you were having trouble reading.
Nope. Can I ask you a question?
Sure, I guess.
Are you going to be my new big brother?
your big brother?
My last one moved away.
What, What exactly did your Uncle Pike tell you about me?
He's not my uncle. I met him from the Big Brother program. He said you volunteered.
Said I volunteered, huh?
Yeah.
I'm gonna kill him.
Can I have one?
Sure, help yourself. Well, thanks, bud. Some newspaper. You know something? This just might work out.
What this dying world could use is a willing man of God, who dares to go against the grain and work without applause. A man who'll raise the shield of faith, protecting what is pure, whose love is tough and gentle, a man whose word is sure. God doesn't need an orator who knows just what to say. He doesn't need authorities to reason him away. He doesn't need an army to guarantee a win. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion, who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. He calls the broken derelict whose life has been renewed. He calls the one who has the strength to stand up for the truth. Enlistment lines are open, and he wants you to command. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion, who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion, who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion, who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. He just needs a few good men. He just needs a few.
Awesome, guys. Thank you. Well, good morning. Yes, that's good. You like that, huh? That's good stuff. Well, hey, we've been talking about seasons of life, and this week we're hitting midlife, a season of life that's very special to me. Because if I live to be 116, I'm prime midlife. Midlife. the autumn of life, the season of life. And you know, specifically, we're talking about baby boomers this morning. Now, don't check out if you're not a baby boomer, because you're going to hit midlife one of these days if you're not there yet. And I'm sure you know someone, maybe your own parents who are there, or you have friends who are there, and perhaps you can help them. Besides, there are things we're going to talk about this morning that anyone at any time can put into practice in their life. Baby boomers was the greatest population boom to ever hit the United States, ever, ever. For the 17, 18 years following World War II, from 1946 to 1964, in that period of time, 77 million babies were born. 77 million babies were born in the United States. This was a crowd of flower children, peaceniks, protesters, activists, social reformers, and would-be world changers. When we were born, we knew we were going to change the world. You know, we just knew it. We were cause-oriented. We knew that was going to happen. My generation has always been passionate. We've always demanded to be heard. As we came into the world and came into young adulthood, we rocked our world. No question. The protest, all the things that were going on, you know all about that. Because this generation, the baby boomers, were idealistic dreamers and workers. We were determined to make the world a better place. In fact, that famous song that's been reprised over and over again, "We Are the World, We Are the Children," it's a baby boomer song. That doesn't belong to the kids, that belongs to us guys. That's a baby boomer song. And I have to tell you, inside every 55-year-old, is a 25-year-old that's asking, what in the world happened? You know, how did I get here? And how did life turn out to be this way? How did it be here? Well, I'll tell you what happened. If you're younger than us, think back to what you learned in history. If you're around my age or older, you lived it. You know what happened. The Vietnam War happened. That happened. Every person my age can remember exactly where they were when John F. Kennedy was killed. Everybody remembers that. And in quick succession, it was Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy. In a period of time as we were growing up there, coming into adulthood, being part of the world that we desperately hoped to change and that we felt that we could have some influence over, harsh reality hit us. It hit us hard. And as time went on, we merged into the very kind of people that we fought against to start with. By the time we hit our 40s, I mean, check it out. Jane Fonda. You know, some of the protesters, the ones who were in big trouble, you know, they became part of the establishment that we fought so much. By the time we hit our stride in the middle of life, we were part of the establishment, we were part of the institutions, we were part of the very success industry that we had opposed. And I want to tell you what a big group we are. Every 7 seconds, another baby boomer turns 50. Count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Bingo! If you're not there yet, hang on. You'll get lucky soon. It will be you. It will be you. It happens all the time. C.S. Lewis, a really profound and famous author in the last years, he wrote a book called The Screwtape Letters. And in it, it's a story, a fictional story, but very profound and could be very true to life. He wrote a story about a head demon named Screwtape. And Screwtape, in the letters, he's writing letters to his protege, another younger demon, and the younger demon's name is Wormwood. And he's telling him a variety of things about how to attack the human race, what to do with them. And do you know what he says in there? He said that midlife is a particularly great time to destroy people. He said, you can do that. Just focus in on people in midlife because it's a great time to destroy them. Because you can get some of them because they look back at their life and they look at the hopes and the dreams that they had and they realize all the frustration they have and they look at life and they say, I'm never going to be what I thought I could be. I'm never going to do that. They've had a relationship hurt. They've had broken dreams. They've had all different kinds of things. And some of them, Wormwood, you can pull into the pits of despair, and they'll make dumb decisions and ruin their life because that's where they are. And then he told Wormwood, and then some of the others, the ones that are riding the high waves of success, just keep pushing it. Just keep pushing it. Because here's what you can do. Instead of just finding their place in the world, you can make sure that the world finds its place in them. And they give themselves over to all the wrong things. Well, I think he nailed it, don't you? I think he got it. As a person in midlife myself, I think he got it. God would like us to live with eternity in view. Satan would like us to live as if this is the only place there is, and either despair or get really fixated on this is the only place. That's what he would really like. Midlife, I can assure you, is either meaningful or miserable. One of those two. No other options. Meaningful or miserable, and it depends on the choices that you make. It hinges on all of those, and so we want to make good ones. I want to suggest a few choices that you can make regardless. In the springtime of your life, perhaps you made some pretty foolish choices. In the springtime of your life, you may have made some really good choices. Whatever you chose then, now is a time to make some really good choices and make the rest of your life the best of your life. What's the first thing that you and I need to do at this stage of life? What's the best thing to do in autumn to harvest your crops? The first thing is to resolve your past. Choose to resolve your past. You know, you don't get to be this age without having a past, right? You don't get to be midlife. You know the social networking movie that's out there. And the tagline says you don't get like 500 million friends without making a few enemies, right? That's the way it is for all of us. You don't get to be this age without having some disappointments, some broken relationships, some people that have hurt you, and some people that you have hurt. So what are you going to do to make life meaningful? How are you going to do that? Well, first of all, you have got to choose to resolve this portion of your life. How do you do it? The first thing that you do is choose to forgive. Just choose to forgive. Choose not to hold that thing over somebody's head for the rest of their life. Why let your past experiences, things that happened 10 or 20 years ago, why let those things color my experiences today? Why should I do that? Forgive, it's just not worth it. Bitterness inside of us is a harsh, harsh thing. And it makes you old before your time. It makes you struggle. So if you have anyone that you haven't forgiven this morning, you need to do it. You need to do it before it eats you alive. Resolve your past by forgiveness. Another way to resolve your past is to ask forgiveness. You know, you didn't get to be this age without hurting somebody else either. You've done some things either on purpose or accidentally. Try to reconcile with them. Doesn't mean the relationship has to go back to the way it used to be, but ask forgiveness. Reconcile the very best that you can. Paul tells us this in the Word of God. He says, listen, as much as it is your responsibility and under your control, live at peace with everyone. As much as it's under my control, live at peace with everyone. So what's that mean to people who won't forgive me, who won't be a part of my life? What's that mean for me? You got anybody like that? You know, if you got anybody like that, it hurts. You don't like for life to be that way. What are you going to do about it? I remember the first experience I had with this was when Charlie and I were young, just out of the gate pastoring in Cincinnati. And a lady there decided that she hated me. She just decided that she hated me. And I had asked her forgiveness for every possible thing I could possibly think of. And I think what really had happened is I had taken her job, didn't know I took her job. But when we met each other, she just hated me. And it was rough. It was very, very rough. And I did everything that I could. And I was beginning to be depressed over this relationship. I cried a lot over it. And I did a very intelligent thing that some of you should do. I talked to a counselor about it, Fred Van Tatenhove, who was counselor down there at the school that we went to. And I talked to him about it. And I told him about my experience. I told him about my pain. And I was sitting there crying in his office. And he said, listen, have you done everything you know to do? Have you tried to have a conversation with her? Have you asked her forgiveness for anything that you might have done or have done? Have you invited her to tell you how you hurt her? Have you done all of that? And I said, yes, I have. And he said, well, then quit eating your heart out over it. On your end of the street, it's peaceful. Let her be the one who stays up nights. don't do it to yourself. It's a good choice. Good choice. There's nothing wrong with talking to a counselor or talking to someone and tell them about the pain of your past. Listen, some of you who are here today, you could raise the quality of your life immediately by making a phone call or writing a letter this week. You could raise the quality of your life a lot by just taking steps to resolve your past. Okay, so what else are you going to do? You're going to have to make another choice. You're going to have to embrace the present. You're going to have to give the present a big old hug and like it. I have to tell you, I have never understood people lying about their age. I've never understood that. I know that it's a thing that, you know, probably some men do it sometimes, but we women are accused of it all the time. And lots of women, you know, lie about their age and they want to look as young as their daughters and all this kind of stuff. Man, I don't get it. But I will tell you this. If I ever lie about my age, I'm going to go the other direction, not backwards. Because see, here's what I know. If I tell you that I'm 49, inside yourself, you go, whew, she must have had a rough life. You know? But if I tell you that I'm 70, you say, whoo, that woman's beautiful. Think of what she must have looked like when she was young, you know? So if you're going to lie about it, you know, at least put yourself in a good direction. Do that. You want to embrace the present. You want to love your life. If you're going to be happy in midlife or any other time, you've got to decide to love your life. You can't wait until it gets in a lovable place to love it. You have to decide to love your life right now. It's all you've got. So how are you going to embrace the present? Well, one thing I want to encourage you is make your default answer yes. Your default answer, yes. You know, some of us, by the time we hit midlife, and some of us have had that in our personalities whole life, our default answer is no. If we don't know, we just say no. We've already got the no forming on our lips before the kids say anything, before our spouse says anything. It's just no. No. You want to go? No. You want to do? No. 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 What you want to do is change your default and make yourself much more prone, decide to be more prone to say yes than no. Most of the time, you'll be glad that you did. You know what else you need to do? You need to choose to make your basic perspective about life, not that God doesn't care and not that you're a victim and not that life is hard and not any of that. You want to choose to make your basic perspective on life. And again, this is a choice. It's a choice. You want to make your choice to say this. I believe that God is good. I believe that I am incredibly loved, more than I can even begin to imagine. And I believe that God's working a plan. That's what you want to tell yourself. You want to do that. You want to coach yourself. Say positive things to yourself. Tell yourself, this is the day the Lord has made. God is good. Isn't life wonderful? Coach yourself to say those things and you will begin to believe them. Tell yourself that you are unique and loved. How else do you embrace the present? Well, decide to be the host of every party you can. I don't mean just having parties at your house. I mean doing it like Jesus. Jesus didn't have a house to have a party in, right? He was an itinerant preacher. He walked around. He didn't have a roof over his head. He didn't have that. He was always at other people's places. But when he went to a party or he went to a dinner, or he went to anything with a group of people, it didn't matter whose house it was, he mentally decided he was the host of the party. He mentally decided that he would be the one in charge of making sure that everybody felt good. He would be the one who went around and talked to the person who wasn't talking to anybody. He would be the one who inspired. He would be the one. He would be the one. He would bring his positive energy to the place. He would do that. Do you know what? You and I need to do that. If we're going to embrace life, we need to be the people who bring life into the room, not suck it out. Y'all know people who, when they come into an atmosphere, you can just feel the energy and joy just go, don't you? Y'all know that. They're critical. They're depressed. They're the ones who've always got a problem. And it just, you know, you try to avoid them if you can. Wouldn't it be awful if someone tries to avoid you? Wouldn't it be awful if people try to stay away from you because you're the downer? You're the one always bringing it down? Listen, you and I need to make positive choices in life. We need to decide that every meeting will be more positive because I'm in it. Every party will have more life because I'm in it. Every place I go will be more hopeful, more inspiring because I'm there. I'm going to be the host of every party. I'm going to walk in. I'm going to talk. I'm going to encourage people. I'm going to inspire people. I'm going to lift the level every place I go. And you know what will happen? When you do that for other people, you get it back for yourself. When you sit around thinking, boy, life is hard. Man, I tell you, I don't know. My kids, my spouse, my job, my whatever. I'm so lonely. Everybody's rejected me. Yeah, everybody with sense has. They've all walked away because no one can put up with that. You and I need to embrace life if we don't want to be miserable at midlife or any other time. We need to embrace life. Make it a party when you get there. If it's dead before you arrive, lift the place when you come. Do it. And I want to encourage you to do this. I want to say this specifically about Sunhee. I was talking about her this week. And I said, here's the truth. We cannot pay for the good that she brings to our church. We can't do it. You know why? Because she's a lifter. Every place she comes to gets energy. I love it. I wish I could make her come to both services. Because the services are better when she's here. They are. She's enthusiastic. She worships. She prays. She's with it. She's singing the song. She's doing that. Why don't y'all do that? Why don't we all do that? Why don't we decide to lift the atmosphere where we go? Embracing life, it's really important. Then, what about the future? If we want to have a meaningful life, we need to choose to create a legacy for the future. You know, my husband's church, they're adding on, building a new sanctuary, and he challenged them to do what we had done here when we built this building. He challenged them to come on a day when they got all the two-by-fours up, the studs were up, everything was up around, and he challenged everybody to come and to take magic markers and go around and write scripture verses and whatever they wanted to all over the place. And I'm seeing smiling faces. Some of you remember doing that in our buildings here. Well, one young man down there, his name is Owen Miller. He's not 10 years old yet. He already has the picture of how to build a legacy. Look what he wrote. If you're a Miller, hi, I'm your grandpa. When I saw that on the wall, I started laughing and crying at the same time. I thought, is this not incredible? This kid's not even 10 years old yet. And he's already made a decision. I'll be in this church my whole life. I'm going to have kids. I'm going to be a grandpa. They're going to come to this church. They're going to participate. If you're a Miller, hi, I'm your grandpa. Isn't that awesome? That's wonderful. And that's the kind of thing that you and I need to be thinking. We need to be thinking about leaving a legacy. How do you do it? Will you invest for the future? This is a hard thing for when we get to midlife. We don't want to invest in the future because, let's be frank, those young people threaten us, right? They're always changing the music. They're changing the style. They're changing the program. They're changing everything. And they're taking our jobs, for pity's sakes, right? It's very, very difficult. I want to encourage you to invest in the future, and the young people that are part of the future, don't fear them. Let them mentor you. Listen, our church is a healthy church today. And we're growing, ministering to getting close to 1,000 people on the internet every Sunday. And we're having people's lives changed here, all kinds of enthusiasm, all kinds of good things happening. And guess what? I have to tell you, a whole large part of that has been because I haven't been afraid of the young people. I love them. I want as many of them serving on our staff as I can because they mentor me. They tell me what works and what's cheesy and what doesn't work and what's fun and what will reach their generation. Hey, I'm telling you, we boomers, we're kings and queens of cheese. We really are. And we don't know it. We don't know that the things that we think are funny are turning off the kids. We don't know that. So we need to be surrounded by them. We need to invest in them. And I have to tell you, I learned to be open with the young people from some of the people that are here in this church. People who were my age when Charlie and I moved here. Fred and Verla, they were in their 50s when we moved here. Dean and Bernice were crowding into that time period when we moved in here. Leith and Harold, the people that were here, the Millers, they believed in us. They trusted us. The Sims, They believed in us. They let us go ahead and do our thing, even though it was different. They trusted. They invested us. And now it's my turn to do that. Now it's my turn to not believe that I hold the truth for the way everything ought to always be done forever. It's my turn to invest in young people and say, yeah, well, let's just go ahead and try that. Let's just see. It just might work. It might be a really good thing. One of my favorite stories for this age of my life is from the Bible in the book of Luke. I love it. It's a Christmas story, but we don't hear it too often. It's after Jesus was born. When he's 8 days old, his parents take him into the temple to dedicate him. And there's two people there who are now past midlife, but during midlife from their young time on, the Bible says their names are Anna and Simeon, and the Bible says that they spent all of their life in the house of God. And so here they are, you know, they could be retired, but they're still in the house of God. This is what they're doing. They're still there. They're investing their life there. And they've been praying that God will do something great in their generation. They've been praying that God would bring a Messiah, that the right person would happen. And so they're praying. They're in tune with God. And so when this young baby gets carried in, I want you to think about it. He's a young baby, a poor baby. He's carried in by two poor parents. They only have a turtle dove to give for a sacrifice. They don't have the real deal. They don't have a lamb. They come in there. They don't look like they'll ever amount to anything. But Simeon and Anna looked at them with legacy maker eyes. They looked at these three people with faith and hope. And God was able to stir in their heart. And they said, "Woo! It's it. It's what we've been praying for. The Messiah is here. This child is going to be blessed. This is going to be wonderful." And before even knowing, now I want you to keep in mind, we've got the scriptures backwards. You know, we get to read them now. We know who he was. They didn't know anything. The dude hadn't done a miracle. You know, he was a little crying baby in his mother's arms, dirty diaper, the whole bit. That's who he was. And yet they looked at him and they were willing to stake their faith. They were willing to take a risk. And they said, this is a chosen one. This is the chosen one. This is who he is. They invested in him before he did anything. Now listen, you and I, us older people, we need to be investing in these young people. We need to be thinking about all the good things they can do. We need to be looking at them and not waiting for them to prove themselves to us. We should be opening wide the doors and investing in them and saying, come on, give it a shot. You know what? So if you screw up a little bit, we'll help you fix it. We'll get it better. We'll go on. We want to do that. You and I want to bless the young people. Don't hoard our authority. Let's make sure they get to serve on the board. Let's make sure that they get to do amazing things. Let's get them up here. Let's do different things. Let's do that. And in your job where you are and in your family, don't be afraid to take advice from the young people. If you're a parent and you've got grown kids, some of the best things you can do is listen to those kids. They'll tell you some good stuff. Let them grow, mentor them, and release them. That's what I want to tell you. The generation that is coming up right now is the most gifted generation in all of human history, in my mind. They have the technical tools. They have the brain power. They have all kinds of stuff. And guess what? They're cause-oriented. They care about clean water. They care about recycling. They care about our environment. They care about AIDS. They care about all these things. Don't you want to invest in them? See, I think about all the things my generation cared about and how we wanted to be generous and how we wanted to be good and how we wanted to be great. And I think about how the hope got crushed out of us and we became cynical and success-driven just like everybody else. Don't you want to make it easier for the next generation to make a difference than it was for you? Don't you want to? I do. I got to tell you, as a person in ministry, as a woman in ministry, I have had some tough scrapes. It's been pretty difficult. I've cried lots of tears over being who I am. And I got to tell you, one of my dreams is that my daughter and my granddaughter, if Jesus comes back again, doesn't come back before then, that they're going to have an easier time in ministry than I did. That they're going to be opened, welcomed with arms open. I want them to have just cheering I want them to have blessing as they begin the ministry. And don't you for your children? Don't you for all of our children? Don't you want them to have it easier than we did? We do that by encouraging them and by challenging them. Another way we create a legacy for the future is by living generously. It's a sad commentary on my generation that sometimes the biggest goal we have is to retire early. We just want to retire early. Want to retire early, we want to sleep in, we want to shop. Brother Doug, we want to play golf. We want to do that. And what's wrong with that? Absolutely nothing. There's nothing wrong with it. And go ahead and do it. Sleep in some, shop some, play some golf. But after you do some of that, what then? What else? You can't golf your whole life. How many crossword puzzles can you do? How many John Wayne reruns can you watch? I mean, eventually, don't you want to do something else? Yeah, you want to live generously. Did you know that there's a high rate of depression? One of the fastest growing depressed groups in our society are people who have been retired 2 to 3 years. Why is that? Because they got the early retirement and they don't have to go to work, but they've quit doing anything that feels like it matters. You don't want to do that. You want to live generously. You want to build for eternity. You and I want to give our resources away. If we happen to have more money because the kids have moved out, let's give it away. It's like we saw this morning. You got more time? Be generous with it. Make a difference in the lives of young people. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, this is what we're told. All of us. All. How many is all? All. All of us will appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account for the deeds done in our body, whether good or evil. Hey, those of us with more time on our hands than we've had for a while, we're not taking care of little ones on a regular basis. We've hit midlife. We've got time and we want to be generous with it. Do some things that will count for eternity. And then last, I want to encourage you. If you want to be meaningful, have a meaningful life, not a miserable life, be fearless. Be fearless. Take some risk. See, the only problem with getting higher up on the ladder is you're really afraid to fall, right? It's just, we get there. The higher you go, the more you're afraid to fall. You and I need to take risk. I want to encourage you to take the risk. Maybe go on a mission trip. Maybe do that. Maybe go someplace you've never gone before. I want to encourage you to maybe go downtown and serve what Jesus said. Maybe talk to your neighbor. Share Jesus in a way you've never shared before. Hey, you know, you've already made it in life. You're already, you know, you've already had a spouse. It's really funny when Charlie was in an accident and he got this bad scar on his head and the insurance would not pay for plastic surgery. You know why? Because he was already married, he already had kids, and he was over 30. And they said he didn't need to look good anymore. And so here we are. You know, if you're anywhere close to my age, you don't need to worry about that anymore. You don't need to worry about it. Quit spending all your time worrying about your body looking good and your hair looking perfect and all that. Be fearless. Take some risk. Do something that's significant and important. Share Jesus. What do you have to lose? Don't preach. Be positive. Love them into the kingdom. Do that. And I especially want to ask you to pray for Sunhee. Too long of a story to tell you now, but this trip to Korea, if I could have chosen any time in the entire year to go, it certainly would not be now. But God chose it. We didn't know this. We didn't know this. Her father has stomach cancer, and he's not a believer. She hasn't seen him in 12 years. She's going to get to share Jesus with him. You pray and believe that he'll accept Christ, okay? You do that. It's going to be a wonderful thing. God worked it all out. He did that. Share Jesus. Share joy. Share joy. Be the most positive person around. You share joy. Do that. Practice what you preach. And all of those people younger than you, the people surrounding you, everything you wish they would be that yourself. If you wish they would be pure, be pure. If you wish they would work on their marriage, work on yours. If you wish they would be honest, you be honest. If you wish they would be kind, you be kind. If you wish they would be a faithful Christian, you be a faithful Christian. If you wish they knew how to pray, then you pray. Everything you want them to be that yourself. Because people will always love and accept an example. They won't always accept our words. A scripture verse that I love, I've asked God to make it the keystone of my life at this age, is found in Proverbs chapter 31. It's the scripture that talks about a virtuous woman, what she's like. And it talks about her as she goes through life and as she gets to being a mature woman. It says she has no fear. Listen to what it says. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. See, that's who I want to be. I don't want to waste 1 minute of my one and only life worrying about crow's feet or laugh lines or anything foolish. I don't want to worry about that. I want to be clothed with strength and dignity. And when I look into the future and I think that in, 2 years I'll be 60, in 12 years I'll be 70. If I live, in 22 years, I'll be 80. I don't want that to freak me out. I want to laugh at the days to come. I want to say, here, there, in the air, however he wants to get me, I'm ready. I'm ready. The words of a great song say this: no guilt in life, no fear in death. No guilt in life, no fear in death. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus controls my destiny. Hey, if I believe that, I got a great life. I got a great life. I'm 58 years old. Became that on October 22nd. I am proud and grateful to be here. And the future doesn't scare me. Doesn't scare me. I'm laughing at the days to come. My grandpa lived to be 101. If I live to be that age, I can guarantee you I'm going to be one funny-looking little woman. I can promise you that. But here's what I also promise you. I'm going to have joy that overflows. Because my life is meaningful, not miserable. It's because of the choices I'm making. And you can make them too. Life needs to be looked at seriously and joyfully like this. Pray with me, please. Our Father, we thank you that you've given us life, that you've given us enough measure of health that we're here today. We thank you that you've given us another opportunity to do things that matter for eternity. I pray that no one will have a fight today over anything that's not going to matter in eternity. I pray that no one will make a choice to follow something today that's not going to matter in eternity. Father, I pray that you would help us to live our one and only life with great meaning, and that we'll do it with joy. Help us to laugh at the days to come because we've examined our lives and we're living in concert with you. We ask it in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the ushers to come give you an opportunity to give your tithes and gifts to the Lord. Thank you for stepping up to the challenge magnificently. We're doing well. If we keep up what we're doing, we'll be completely on track by the end of the year, and we want to do that. If you're watching by way of the web, we are so glad that you're here with us, and we hope that you'll find this to be a church home for you. You can click on the click to donate button there now if you would like to give as well. Let me share a few things with you. The kids department. You need to invest in the future. Kids department is a great place to do it, and they are in desperate need of a few helpers to work with the kids and do life-changing things with them on Sunday mornings. If you can do that, you can stop by the Welcome Center and tell them, yes, let Pastor Karen know, let Pastor Gordo know. Please do that. It will benefit you and will benefit them. What's around the corner? Orientation for newcomers is next Sunday at 10:20 a.m. in between our two services. If you're a new attender at Cornerstone, relatively new, and you're not 100% sure what goes on here and how you could participate, Pastor Jeff will be meeting with you. That'll be a great way to get connected. This coming Friday night is Family Friday. You can bring board games and your family and come back to Heritage Hall. They'll be having a great time back there playing games together, and refreshments are provided. And on Saturday night is Married Life Live, and it's because great marriages take work. They do. It's going to be fun, a fondue night. You can check that out in your worship folder. Next week is winter. Keeping warm with snow on the roof, we're going to honor our senior adults next week, and it's going to be so great. And let me tell you, a special treat. Come early, because at the beginning of the service, John Lemiel is going to be doing some amazing big band sax music up here. The music of the senior adults era, that's great. And you know, there's just some little treats in store. You don't want to miss it. Thank you for your prayers, Sunhee, and I appreciate them. We'll be headed for the airport at 1:45 this afternoon, taking off at 4:50, and we will definitely appreciate your prayers. Once we get to L.A., we have a five-hour layover, and then it's 12 hours from there to Seoul, Korea. We'll be hopping on a train for about a two-hour train ride, and when we get out of the train, we get to change clothes, and then we're on. So pray for us. Pray for us. And if not, I said, if I don't preach very good, it's no big deal. Sunhee will probably say anything she wants to say anyways, and I'll never know the difference. Would you stand with me, please, and receive the blessing of the Lord? May Christ our Savior walk with you today and every day until that great day after a meaningful, wonderful life, we all find ourselves finally home. Amen.